It's not working.
Emma.
Yes?
20 years. 20 years in films.
Yes.
But you haven't really performed in London on the West End stage.
No.
In a long time. I mean, why Sweeney Todd? Why the Coliseum? Why this project to do that now at this time?
It was the opportunity that you offered, John, in my dressing room in New York. Not that one. This one. I hadn't been on stage. No, you're absolutely right. I try not to think about that. It's a bit pointless, really. You've got to keep doing different things, flinging yourself, leaping into the dark, as Agnes de Mille, I believe, so famously said. Otherwise, you get a bit samey. And people get bored. So when I was asked originally by the New York Philharmonic and Lonnie Price to perform this extraordinary piece, which I knew very well, because I've seen it many times, and my great friend Imelda Staunton had just triumphed in it. So, of course, I said to Imelda last year, what do you think? Do you think I could manage it? And she just looked at me, she gave me this look. If you start working on it now, August, you might be okay. Note the might being the operative word. But then I was in the back garden and my mum came and I said, I've been asked by the New York Philharmonic to sing with Bryn Terfel. And she said, oh my dear, you simply must do it. And so I did, and I had no idea what it would involve, but you came to see it, and I you asked us here, which was extraordinary of you, and the chance to do it again was absolutely, well, it was like a dream coming true, really, because I thought we were coming to the end of it, and it was so terrible to think of it ending. And then you said, well, it might not have to end, and you could come to the Coliseum, which is my favourite theatre in London, particularly that little round bit on the top, which I used to love. I remember when I was allowed to feed the pigeons in Trafalgar Square with my grandmother when I was tiny, when there were still pigeons, and they had been chased away by people with hawks. It's all very different now. And the thought of playing this piece in London, this revolutionary piece about poverty and deprivation, this great music and these amazing words, and with man who I worship above all others. I mean, apart from my husband, obviously, and you, and obviously the Michaels, who I also worship. I feel very worshipful this morning.
Well, to mention the point, you bring music, theatre and opera together. Maybe these two roles clearly define what that means, because Sweeney is definitely undoubtedly operatic. I defy anybody to sing his Epiphany without really thinking that is a very difficult aria, song, whatever you want to call it, to perform. Whereas Mrs. Lovett gives you such vehicle.
You know? So I've heard you sing it. I can speak it, really. I'm channeling Rex Harrison while I do it.
Again, I would say, if anybody wants to learn a couple of pages, just as a matter of interest, go to the second act of Valkyra and go to Votan's monologue, or try and sing Mrs. Lovett's first utterance on the stage. And you have to remember, I saw this piece now with a new palette, because I saw it through the eyes of Emma, who had been learning it for months, and we had a week up in Hampstead to rehearse just with the music staff and the director, and everything was new for me. Emma was saying she loves singing, she loves performing this piece, she loves sometimes collaboration with words and music. Then in New York, for instance, we have this term in the operatic realm, Sitzprobe, which is when you sing with the orchestra for the first time, and it literally is to sit down and sing it. That's hence Sitzprobe. But to see Emma's reactions to sing with the New York Philharmonic for the first time actually brought tears to the instrumentalists. And these are die-hard people that have played all kinds of repertoire. Mahler, Shostakovich, you know, just everything, Beethoven. And then all of a sudden they have Emma Thompson in front of them singing this with every nuance that she could possibly have. It was just mesmerising.
Well, we're thrilled.
So that's why I've come back to Sweeney Todd. It gives you those roles. Sweeney Todd is an incredible vocal vehicle, but also so difficult. You know, you don't rest on your laurels with him. It's a little bit like the role of Scarpia in Tosca. If you really delve into this misfit and malcontent onto that stage, it really might hamper your performance. So you have to really sometimes take a step back.
Well, there's a distance with the audience. The relationships, the intensity of the relationships when you're making a film are very different because your relationship is with a camera, which is a very intense and important relationship, and with the crew, who are your audience in a way. Mm. But it is an internalised performance. It's a completely different thing. To come back and, after all that time, with having worked different muscles, and then use those muscles. I mean, Michael and I were first together years ago when Mike did comedy with me and made me do comedy on stage, and then we did Me and My Girl. You were there all those years ago, so we've known each other for absolutely centuries. And when I say centuries, obviously, I mean just a couple of years. And magical to be in front of an audience again. It was the exchange is so beautiful, so inspiring. So it's something that it made me weep. It's just what comes along. You know this thing of, oh, career, you've got to do it. I've never understood that. It's just what happens at the time and what you think, oh, that's interesting, I'd like to do that. I mean, I might have been screenwriting or... and then, of course, becoming a mother and my mum worked in the theatre when we were little. And as we discussed, I discussed it with her. It's sometimes... That's hard. Because you're leaving your children just as they come home from school, and then the timings of it. Films sometimes seemed to me to fit motherhood slightly better, but I don't know why. I haven't got a sensible answer to that. It wasn't a choice. It was just what came along. I've done it this year before, and it felt. Like, I've never been so frightened, ever. What I'm hoping for is a slight improvement in London. What I mean is by that, no nausea, no actual nausea. If I could manage the fear without the nausea, I'd be really happy. Because I was frightened, wasn't I? You, having Bryn there, it's like, it's fantastic, because I was there, and then I'd turn around and... There was the Rock of Gibraltar, who always knew what note it was. And there's some little bits, but you were talking about how difficult it is. It's a very difficult score. It's fantastically complex. And there are some bits in God, That's Good, where he's a beast, Stephen, because he writes these runs of notes, and you think you're going to be allowed to repeat them in the next verse. But oh, no, he changes them. That if you listen, you look at that score, the complexity of it just is, it's a bugger, to put it mildly.
But I wouldn't worry about her not being on the stage for 25 years. You should see the reaction of that audience.
No, do worry about it. I think you should worry about it a lot and then be pleasantly surprised. That's what would be nice. Could you all get really concerned now?
Not when you have that cleaver in your right hand, Emma.
Not Me and My Girl. Because I did that for 15 months and became clinically depressed. I think it was the effect of having to be so cheerful every night. However, I would love to, yes, and I'm sure that will happen.
Any more questions?
He came to the first and last nights of our first run at this. He was terrific. He said to me on the first night, came into the dressing room before the show, leaned against the jamb of the door and said, "Don't f*** it up." Do I sing in the bath? I haven't had a bath for some time. Because I'm trying to conserve water, you see. So I have showers, but I do sing in the shower. Yeah, I do, actually. That's a hilarious question. I have to repeat that on mic. Do I feel slightly better about myself because I'm helping the ENO financially? I know that you didn't mean that in that way, but it is a very funny question. To which the short answer is, of course, a resounding no. I think the ENO managed perfectly well without the likes of me for quite some time. It's Mr. Terfel. Don't, for God's sake, do the old Terfel. You'll get it in the neck. Terfel. It's such a beautiful language, Welsh. I've heard a lot of it since I met Bryn. It's absolutely glorious.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming. Emma and Bryn.